Do you ever feel that climate change is so huge that nothing you can do will be enough? I'd really like to know how many of you feel that. Put your hand up if you felt that. Oh my God, it's basically the whole room. Well, I feel that too, and this talk's for you. I'm a parent, probably like a lot of you, and I've got three beautiful little boys. Here they are, mesmerized by some fish. The photo I took a little while ago. And the eldest, as I was tucking him into bed the other night, just looked up at me with intent in his eyes, and he said, "Dad, we learnt about climate change at school today. Is it true that we've only got 12 years to fix it?" And I hesitated because, frankly, this is quite tricky, these time questions. And we basically need to do it as soon as possible. But I said, "Yeah, darling, that's roughly right." And he looked very worried and said, "That means it has to be fixed before I'm a grown-up, which means that we're relying on you, Dad, and your friends." And he is. He's relying on you and me. And I feel that pressure because he's right, that there isn't a lot of time. Now, there are many reasons to be worried about climate change. Storms, floods, droughts, running out of food, mass migration. But I want to start by talking about something that's very dear to my heart and probably dear to any lover of nature. I'm Australian. Yes, after 20 years in Europe, you may not be able to hear that in my voice anymore. But like many Aussies, I've snorkeled and scuba dived on the Great Barrier Reef. And it is one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. The colors, the stunning beauty of the coral, it's really quite profound. And yet, at 1.5 degrees of warming, we lose 70 to 90% of this reef. And at 2 degrees, we've lost more than 99%. And that's what we're going to have. We're already over 1 degree of warming. So it's a little bit more, and we're there. A small change, huge impact. We could wipe out a precious, unique ecosystem that is 4 times the size of Austria. You can see it from space. Small changes can have big impacts. Now, I'm not here to talk to you about runaway change to an uninhabitable planet. I'm here to talk to you about runaway change to a better world. And with my brilliant colleagues at the University of Oxford, this is what we are trying to tackle. We are looking for these sensitive intervention points where we can intervene in the socioeconomic and political system with modest changes to deliver massive, fast impact, because actually nothing less will do at this stage. And our research is building on several decades of complex systems science. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to take you through the maths, but the basic point here is that these equations help us to understand how it is that the flapping of the butterfly's wings can lead to the tornado over the other side of the world. Now, the system has to be primed and ready for these kind of big impacts, but this frequently happens in physical systems. But we're looking elsewhere, because these kind of dynamics also apply in social systems. If we go not far away from here in Berlin and roll back in time, 30 years, almost to the day, the Berlin Wall came down. Berlin was primed for this, but what happened was a few people climbed on the wall and started knocking it down. And with those steps, we had the reunification of East and West, the fall of communism in Europe, and the end of an economic paradigm. Powerful, huge impacts from small initial steps for a system that is primed. So how do we get a handle on these dynamics and use them for climate? Well, a key element, you know, often in these dynamics is feedback. If you've got A that causes B, and B that also causes A, you've got the possibility of either a vicious circle into chaos or a virtuous cycle up to something you actually want to have. Now, this is also described as amplification, and I think we all have an intuitive sense of what this means and how it works. And what we've found is that there are two sorts of intervention that can shift systems and move us to where we need to go. And I'm going to do something very dangerous with you here. There's over 1,000 of you. I've been told not to do this, but we're going to try a little experiment. So listen hard and please concentrate. So step one, rule one, and you've got to follow the rules, is sit down. Great. Right, we're off to a brilliant start. Well done, everyone. Step two is going to be a bit trickier, so I really need you to focus now. So step two, please stand up if and only if someone next to you or in front or behind you is standing up. Nothing's changed. But the system is ready. Now, if I ask my good friend Leonie sitting in the front here to stand up, please, Leo. Let's see what might happen. It's wonderful when an experiment works. You can't believe how much relief I'm feeling watching this kind of Mexican wave in front of my eyes. Wow, all the way to the back. Thank you so much. Please shake the hand of your neighbor, give them a hug, sit down. Whew, right, that's the stressful bit done. So, what does this have to do with climate change? Well, these dynamics, I'm going to explore them with you. We're exploring over 20 different case studies at Oxford where these small interventions might trigger really massive change. So the three cases are technology, mass mobilization, and finance. So let's go through them. First, renewable energy has this fantastic feature of feedback. Unlike fossil fuels, the more solar you build, the cheaper it gets. And the cheaper it gets, the more you want to build. A to B to A again. And solar has fallen in cost by so much that it is now cheaper than fossil fuels in some parts of the world. By our calculations, it will be cheaper than fossil fuels in a majority of the world by the early 2020s. Now, this, to me, is seriously exciting. I don't think we've grasped. Yeah. I don't think we've grasped how significant this is. You're clapping the nerdy scientists who put some solar panels up on satellites, you're clapping the eco-warriors who went early, and then you're clapping those who wanted to take it mainstream. But solar is now going global, and we can power the whole world with solar energy. Now, the naysayers will tell you that it's not going to happen. I get this a lot. They say, Cameron, the sun only shines in the day, as if that's a highly astute observation that I'd never thought of. They also point out, this is slightly more intelligent, that it's really hard to drive electric vehicles on solar because fossil fuels are very energy dense. Well, I've got some good news for you. The same dynamics that are at play with solar energy also apply with batteries. More batteries, cheaper batteries, more batteries, cheaper batteries. And with electric vehicles, more electric vehicles, they get cheaper. The cheaper they are, the more people buy them. And there are beautiful feedback effects between these things. The more solar you have, the more batteries are valuable. So the more you build batteries. And the more you have batteries, the more the solar can work in the night as well. And the more batteries you build, the cheaper they get. And batteries are a big chunk of the cost of an electric vehicle, so EVs get cheaper as well. And these kind of cycles and interacting virtuous effects can be seen across a whole range of technologies that we're exploring. It's really very exciting. Now, the naysayers won't let you go. They'll tell you, you can't power the world with solar because we don't have enough land. You don't want to be carpeting the countryside with solar panels, they say. Well, I've got some good news here. This is the amount of space required. I don't even know if you can see it. Little red squares there? That's what's required to power the whole of human civilization from solar. I think it's doable. I think we've got enough land. And the naysayers will tell you that you can't run a system without coal. We've had coal since the beginning. The British started it with the Industrial Revolution. Take a look at this. This is the amount of coal on the British electricity grid. 6 years ago, it was almost 50%. Today, it's virtually zero. We've taken the coal out. And in due course, we can power this grid entirely with clean energy by converting the electricity from the sun and the wind into molecules like hydrogen and ammonia and using them to power our industry and for energy storage. Small changes can have big impacts, and they do, and it's happening. Let me move on. You all know this lady. She's small. She's had a big impact. And what's going on here is that the system was primed for Greta Thunberg's arrival. 10 or 20 years of education of children means they often know more climate science than the adults do. And they were ready when Greta arrived. Her seemingly futile action of a single person skipping school to protest has ballooned into millions. And you know the story. It is changing political dynamics in every country, certainly here. And we've got millions out. And you know, my son, like these guys, is well aware that us grown-ups need a little bit of help, and I'm grateful to him and to them that they're giving it to us. Small changes can have big impacts. And my last example is around the financial markets. This boardroom is in the City of London, looking over St. Paul's, the heart of the financial system. And I have the privilege of going in there once a quarter. Billions get allocated here. And in similar boardrooms, billions are still being allocated to fossil fuels. This is crazy, given the economics that we've just seen. But there are many small changes here that can have huge impacts. What if we said to investment managers and chief executives that they had to disclose the risks that they're taking by putting money into fossil fuel assets that might be uneconomic? What if a little lawsuit here or there might just put the cat among the pigeons? What if we required companies to explain how they're going to make money in a world that had net zero emissions? Because that's the world we're going to. We've got to go there, and we're going there anyway. So how do you make money in that world? A few small changes in auditing requirements or accounting guidance can have a huge impact. And what we're seeing is that eco-warriors now not only include the bishops and rabbis who are willing to get arrested, but the capitalists in suits seeking to change the system for the betterment of the climate. So what can you do? Go out and protest. Go and vote. Vote for politicians who get this and who are going to put environmental policies into place and support carbon pricing. Buy your energy from someone who will supply clean energy to you, and if they don't, change supplier. Invest your savings in the right sort of companies, and if you don't have any savings, ask your parents to stick their pension in the right place. But whatever you do, tell people about it, because we need this feedback effect and the diffusion effect. So if you do it alone, it has less impact than if you tell your friends, tell your neighbors, tell your family, tell the person you're talking to at the after party tonight, and try not to bore them too much. You know, if you're a vegetarian, tell people that this is good for your health and it's good for the planet. And finally, tell us, because we want to know. Postcarbontransition.net is where I'd like you to go if you've got an idea that you think might scale up. Now, to give you a bit of an incentive, we're offering a cash prize to the best idea and the opportunity to present it to a pretty high-powered board in Oxford in April 2020. The point is that together, humanity can really achieve absolutely amazing results. And the exciting thing for me is that our socio-political systems are now poised. We are at these critical points, and we're at the point where small changes can really make the difference. If we succeed, we'll not only have a cleaner world, but it will be safer, it'll be higher tech, and it'll be more prosperous. And you know what? Going back to my lovely pride and joy of my three little boys, I'm looking forward to a world where I can take them without emissions, completely cleanly, over to Australia to meet the cousins they haven't met yet and to swim, scuba dive, and snorkel on the Great Barrier Reef. Thank you very much.